everyone?
Amen.
Good to be in God's house again, and I can truthfully say I was glad when they said unto me, let's go into the house of the Lord. Pastor Billy, thank you once again for the invitation coming out here and sharing God's word with his people. To begin with, I just have a question for you. How important is worship to you? What does worship mean to you? Do you feel like to worship God is the only way to worship God is to come to church and worship God? Well, I had an experience about 15, 16 years ago where I worked as a courier for FedEx. And I had a radio on top, and I liked to listen to Christian music. And I was driving to my next stop, and it was in Frederick, as a matter of fact. And I was worshiping with the music on the radio. I was having a grand old time. Have you ever been lost in worship? Well, I got lost in my worship there. And I just worshiped, and I just turned into the driveway of the house that I was supposed to live into. And the worship was so good, I closed my eyes and started still singing until the song finished. Little did I realize a little old lady came out of the house. She looked there and said, you go right ahead, you just keep singing, that's all right. I felt a little bit embarrassed. I had my hand out, I was just worshiping, and guess what? I finished the song and then I delivered the package. I think that's a new one from FedEx. How important is worship to you? How important is prayer to you? How important is those two main aspects in your life? Do you see that as a chore in your life, or do you see that as a practice? This morning, we are going to see how significant, how crucial, and how central these subjects need to be in your life. With that in mind, let's have a word of prayer. Father, what a privilege it is to be here in your church, in your body. I thank you for the word you put upon my heart just for your people here this morning. But I pray that there may be a manifestation of your power, of your presence, of your Shekinah glory here in this place. Give understanding to your people. Open up our hearts. May we be reminded. May we understand. And may we be taught, if we haven't, Lord, the importance of prayer and worship in our personal lives. This we pray in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Please turn with me to the book of Acts, chapter 16. Let me give you a little bit of background before I actually get to my main topic here this morning. This is Paul's second missionary journey. And he's traveling with his companions, and now he's traveling through Europe. And look what this verse says here. Now when they had gone through Phrygia and the region of Galatia, and we're looking at verse 6, and were forbidden of the Holy Spirit to preach the word in Asia. Isn't it interesting how the Holy Spirit just forbade them to go into certain cities? There's one time the Holy Spirit stopped, second time the Holy Spirit stopped him. But on this third time, Paul receives a vision from a man from Macedonia begging him to come. He finally reached Philippi, a Roman colony leading into the city of Macedonia. So we'll start there in verse 16. We're still in chapter 16 of the book of Acts, verse 16. Once when we were going to the place of prayer, we were met by a slave girl who had a spirit by which she predicted the future. She earned a great deal of money for her owners by fortune-telling. Isn't it interesting how, have you ever been approached by someone like that on the way to a prayer meeting? But the Apostle Paul was. And now the owners are getting a little bit upset at Paul because look what happens next. Look at verse 17. This girl followed Paul and the rest of us shouting, these men are servants of the Most High God who are telling you the way to be saved. She kept this up for many days. Finally, Paul became so troubled that he turned around and said to the Spirit, in the name of Jesus, I command you to come out of her. At that moment, the spirit left her. When the owners of the slave girl realized that their hope of making money was gone, they seized Paul and Silas and dragged them into the marketplace to face the authorities. They brought them before the magistrates and said, "These men are Jews and are throwing our city into an uproar by advocating customs unlawful for us Romans to accept or practice." The crowd joined in the attack against Paul and Silas, and the magistrates ordered them to be stripped and beaten. After they had been severely flogged, they were thrown into prison, and the jailer was commanded to guard them carefully. Upon receiving such orders, he put them in the inner cell and fastened their feet in the stocks. Isn't that interesting? These owners realized, wait a minute, this girl, this slave girl, she was making us money. All of a sudden, when the demon came out of her and she got delivered, they got upset with the Apostle Paul and with Silas because they couldn't make any more money for themselves. But I thought to myself, would doubt enter into the mind of Paul and Silas because now they were imprisoned? Would that make a difference in a person's life? If you went out and you were in your job and you just felt led of the Lord, this a person came up to you and told you their troubles and everything, and you just felt led of the Lord to say your testimony and share with them a way out, and then in the break room you pray for them, and then when the authorities there, the bosses found out, you got fired. What do you think about that? How would you feel if you went to a country and you preached God's word and then you went to jail for it? I had an experience about 3 years ago. I went to Cuba for the first time to preach and teach the Bible and teach at the pastor's conferences there. Well, when we arrived to Cuba, this was all new to me. This is a communist country. When I arrived, they made us wait in line when we arrived for about 2 hours without attending to us. I didn't stick by. And finally, two officials came out and said, "You and you and you can speak, but you can't speak, and you can't speak, you can't say nothing." And they pointed to me. And they knew that I was not going to speak and everything, because you got to send all that information on ahead before you go into that country. And it was nighttime, we were tired, and the team was really down, and then I said, "Listen, I'll be the best suitcase carrier if that's the only thing that God has called me to be here." And that was down inside of me, but I didn't want to really bring down the team in that case. That night, we went to a house that was guarded by the authorities, and that morning, I got up, and we went to a church building. And a presbyter met me and said, "Are you going to teach the pastors today?" I said to him, "I can't. Government said I can't speak. I can't even stand up and do a greeting. I can't do that." And there were over 200 pastors upstairs waiting for me to give a conference teaching. And literally, I was reading the book of Acts before I went to Cuba and everything, and I said, "Lord, you know, there's a passage there for you to say, I would rather obey God than people." But there was a little bit of a fear and apprehension inside of me, because I knew there are pastors in jail in Cuba right now. And I remember my wife's prayer. You know, it was simple, it was just bring him home, Lord. And I wasn't hesitant. If God wanted me to speak, I'd speak. But there's something that the presbyter said to me that convinced me to speak. And he said, "We appreciate and honor the fact that you're trying to honor our country, but they're the ones in disobedience. You're not." I said, "Okay, let's go." So they put two guards downstairs, put two guards upstairs in the entrance, and two guards in the back. And all they did was tell me, "If we tell you to sit down, sit down." I said, "You have no problem with that." So I stood there sitting on the front rows by myself, and they were doing announcements and everything. They were about to introduce me, and my knees were buckling and shaking and saying, "Lord, you know, I want to be obedient to you." And something took place. I stood up, And as soon as I stood up and opened my Bible and opened up my notebook, all of a sudden the power of the Holy Spirit came upon me and gave me new boldness. As soon as I opened up my mouth, fear left me, trembling left me. I wasn't afraid anymore. I knew that God was in control. See, when you go to Cuba and you're about to speak, you need not only a visa to enter the country, but you need a visa to speak. And so I was a little hesitant, but God moved powerfully that week. I spoke in a lot of churches. I spoke in pastors' conferences. I encouraged the people of God. Things were taking place. We had more time. I will tell you more about it. But God moved powerfully in Cuba. And I'm here to say to you that the church is on fire and alive in Cuba.
Amen.
There are hundreds and hundreds of churches that are still worshiping God and going strong for the Lord. But if I had missed my moment, if I had sat there and said, no, I can't do this, I would have missed the blessing. I had to go through that open window. But today there are some Christians that have been beaten up emotionally, and there are some of you here with things in their lives and they don't know what to do. Perhaps something is really troubling you today, and you say, oh, I'm not sure if I'm going to go to church, but you made it to church. You don't know what to do or where to turn. Your marriage is not where it used to be. Communication is missing. Caring is missing. And all you find yourself is just arguing all the time. Or maybe you're involved in drugs or alcohol because you think that's the only solution. That's the only way out for you in your circumstances. You feel trapped as if you were in prison of helplessness. And you are at the point of totally giving up. I remember a few years ago, I was so troubled by something that was going on in my family's life. And I was so troubled by it. And that day, something had to take place, or something was about to take place. So what I did is I started painting my office in my house. It was, I had planned on it. And there I just put on Christian music, Christian radio station, and I just prayed and prayed and prayed and worshiped and worshiped and worshiped. I'm here to say to you what I painted. Even though the matter was not solved at the time, I experienced a peace that passes all understanding. I can't explain it to you. All I can tell you is something took place. My circumstances will not change, but the inside of my heart was. And that's what happens when we worship and when we pray. And I always say, the greatest time of worship that I have in my personal life is not in the church. It's when I'm alone with God. And it's just Him and me. I'm not trying to impress anybody or anything like that. It's just Him and me. We'll have choices when faced with situations that are beyond our control. But God is in control, isn't He? There was a little boy was on a plane one day, the plane was experiencing violent turbulence. The plane was going up and down, and it was going all over the place. The lady sitting next to the boy was terrified. She couldn't understand why the little boy was happily playing and having fun. So after a while observing him, she couldn't stand it any longer. She said, little boy, please stop it. Stop having so much fun. How can you have fun when the plane is going through this? But I love that little boy's answer. He said this. Put his hand on the lady's hand and said, lady, my daddy is the pilot. How many understand that? Our daddy is the pilot. Like someone once said, Jesus, take the wheel. How many of you that Jesus is not the pilot of your life? That when you go through the hard times, that's, you know what? When you go through hard times, it really reveals who you really are in the Lord. It exposes you. How you turn to Him. But look what happened here in Paul's life when the turmoil started to happen. Look at verse 25. About midnight, Paul and Silas were praying and singing hymns to God, and the other prisoners were listening to them. Suddenly, there was such a violent earthquake that the foundations of the prison were shaken, At once, all the prison doors flew open, and everyone's chains came loose. I was really meditating and thinking about that scripture. You're talking about two men who were beaten, they were stripped, they're bleeding, they're sore, they're tired, they're exhausted, and it was about midnight. I don't know about you, but about midnight, I am asleep. I would not be thinking about prayer, or I wouldn't be thinking about worship, but yet they thought of it. They were going through that pain and the agony. Maybe it was the pain and everything, the cuts that they had experienced that was keeping them awake. But yet they had two things that teaches me, and hopefully it'll teach you, that is nothing to fear about. And here's one of the messages that I hope that you will remember. Here's the message that Paul and Silas were doing there. Find something, in spite of situation, find something to praise God about. Find something to praise about. Midnight, probably their painful posture, their suffering, or their recent scourging that had just taken place prevented their sleeping. But they started praying. They started worshiping God. What type of prayers will we be making? I know the type of prayer perhaps I will be making. Lord, get me out of here. Would that be your prayer? Or how about this? God, if you're going to keep me here, give me the grace. I may not comprehend what you're up to, but please give me the peace that passes understanding. I just thought of a situation that Paul and Silas just sitting there, and their feet, they were on the stockholds there, and they were sitting there, and they were tired, they were exhausted. What about you? And they were in chains. In chains. What about you? What type of chains do you have this morning? Are you chained by your circumstances? Are you chained by your addictions? Are you chained by your doubts? By your lack of faith? That perhaps God can't move in your son's life. God can't move in my daughter's life. You don't understand, Pastor. They're on drugs, they're on alcohol. They're doing all sorts of crazy things. And I've been praying. Sometimes the situation gets rough. I'm here to share with you a great testimony that when you're in that circumstance and you're chained by it, you begin to worship, and you begin to pray. The scripture is not clear as to what Paul prayed, but I cannot just imagine, because I see his prayers in Philippians, Ephesians, Galatians. I see it all in the letters he wrote. I don't even know what song he sung, but perhaps you're there and you're alone with God and you're crying. And God knows you cry at night in your bed, nobody's looking. But perhaps you can sing and be encouraged and just say, and he walks with me, and he talks with me, and he tells me I am his own. And then you continue hoping God, and you keep trusting on him. He'll be there as we tarry there. None other has ever known. And then you're getting encouraged to sing more and say, what a mighty God we serve. Let me tell you something, what happens when you begin to sing, what a mighty God we serve. Angels bow before him. Heaven and earth adore him. Then your faith begins to increase. Then you're no longer sitting, you're standing. You're taking a stand of faith. Then you say, what a mighty God we serve. Then at that moment, God reminds you of all the times he's delivered you in the past. He's rescued you. He's loved upon you. And then you remember God's word that says in Hebrews, I will never leave you or forsake you. Isn't that great? You may have relatives. You may even have some Christians in the church that are not believing that God's going to help you or rescue you. But yet, you have this faith in the living God. I don't serve a dead God. I serve a living God. I serve a God that I know, that I see in the Old Testament and in the New Testament, and he is still doing mighty works today. It doesn't finish in the Bible. He is still working in your life today. You got to believe that. Your circumstances may not change, but you're going to change. And you don't know about praying for that person who's involved in drugs or even for yourself and the bondage and the strongholds. Trust God, because God is working behind the scenes and you can't see that. And sometimes when you pray, the situation is going to get worse with your son, with your daughter, with your grandchild. Why? Because the enemy's fighting. He's fighting so hard. He doesn't want to let go. But I'm here to say to you, and I love what 1 John 4:4 says. It says this: greater is he that is in me than he that is in the world. So therefore, it doesn't matter what type of hole or chain that's upon those people I'm praying about, all my situation, all my circumstance, those chains have to be broken free. As soon as I raise my hand quietly before God, and I start worshiping, and I start praying, and I start trusting and believing that all things are possible with God. Amen. Do you believe that God's word says? Let me give you a few verses. Psalm chapter 30, verse 5, B says this: weeping may remain for a night, but rejoicing comes in the morning. What about this? And it continues: hear, O Lord, and be merciful to me, O Lord. Be my help. You turn my wailing into dancing. You remove my sackcloth and clothe me with joy. Do you know only Jesus can do that? Only Jesus can take that garment of mourning and give you a garment of praise. Then it continues. Isaiah 40, 29, 31. He gives strength to the weary and increases the power of the weak. Even youths grow tired and weary, and young men stumble and fall. But those who hope in the Lord will renew their strength. They will soar on wings like eagles. They will run and not grow weary. They will walk and not faint. What am I doing? 1 Samuel chapter 30 says about David, he says, and David strengthened himself in the Lord. That's what I'm doing. As I read God's word, as I trust in the thousands of promises that are in his word, I am strengthened in the spirit. Isaiah 43:2 says, when you pass through the waters, I will be with you. And when you pass through the rivers, they will not sweep over you. When you walk through the fire, you will not be burned. The flames will not set you ablaze. That's my God. What's another promise that Jesus gives us? Matthew 11:28-29 says this: now I'm tired of all my battling. I'm tired of all my fighting. Then he says this to me. He gives me this invitation: come to me, all who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart. Why? And you will find rest for your soul. That's my Jesus. Psalm 121, 1-3 says this: I lift up my eyes to the Lord. Where does my help come from? My help comes from the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth. He will not let your foot slip. He watches you will not slumber. Here goes another verse. The Lord himself goes before you and will be with you. He will never leave you nor forsake you. Do not be afraid. Do not be discouraged. Deuteronomy 31:8. This morning, God wants to put a new song in your heart. I'm here to say to you, once he does that, you will never worship the same again. I don't need to be convinced. I don't need to be pushed to worship. It will come automatically. He not only wants to put a new song, but he wants to put a new inspiring prayer inside your heart that only you can pray. Now, look at this. The jailer, in verse 27, the jailer woke up, and when he saw the prison doors open, he drew his sword and was about to kill himself because he thought the prisoners had escaped. But let's hold on a second. Let me go back to the first word of verse 26, one of my favorite words in all the scripture. You can underline it, highlight it, because I love it. It says, suddenly. Don't you like that? In other words, it came out of nowhere. Suddenly. I'm here to pray for you this morning for your suddenly to happen. I've been praying and praying and praying about certain things, and then suddenly it comes to pass. Why? Because I'm trusting God, I'm praying. God loves to do the suddenlies in your life. Now look at this. Paul says in verse 28, but Paul shouted, don't harm yourself. We are all here. Isn't it interesting? He was going to kill himself, the guard, because the law was, you let a prisoner leave, you let any prisoner leave, then you're going to be sentenced to death. But Paul says, hold on. We're still here. Now look, 29. The jailer called for lights, rushed in, and fell trembling before Paul and Silas. He then brought them out and asked, sirs, what must I do to be saved? Isn't that great? I thought, where is this man getting this message from about salvation? You know where he's getting it from? Paul was praying in that prison. You are the God of my salvation. You know salvation only comes from you, dear God. He was hearing that message. He was hearing that sermon preached to him. And he knew, what must I do to be saved? That is awesome. And then Paul replies, they reply, believe in the Lord Jesus, and you will be saved, you and your household. Then they spoke the word of the Lord to him and to all others in his house. At that hour of the night, the jailer took them and washed their wounds. Then immediately he and all his family were baptized. You know what I love about here? This is when you begin to pray, when you begin to worship God, when you begin to lift up your hands, when you begin to trust in the living God. Guess what happens? Even those who were once your enemy is now your friend, and he begins to heal your wounds. Isn't that great? That jailer, that was his job to keep him in there. But then when he got saved, I said, I need to wash this man's wounds and his feet. Only my God can do that, to cause your enemies to constantly clean your wounds. Only my God can do that. When God's power begins to take over, people will take note of your changed life. They will start saying to you, perhaps in your job or in your family, why is it that you don't get angry when things don't work out for you? Why is it that you don't slam your fist on the table at any time? When things don't go your way, I notice that you never curse. You never say a bad word out of your mouth. Then you can answer and tell them, it's because the peace that I have in my life is not dependent on my circumstances, but it's dependent on the trust I have in the living God. Hallelujah. To the people closest to you, your contentment, despite your circumstances, will be nothing short of heroic. I trust in the living God, and I dare not trust or lean to my own understanding. Miracles begin to happen if you just hold on and trust God. Let me wrap this up. What are things we can do to help us in this journey? Don't demand anything from God. He doesn't owe us anything, but he will always give us what we need. Another one, don't try to make any deals with God. You can't keep them. Just worship him and let him be God. Many times when people ask me about a certain situation they're going through, my answer is simple. Let God be God. Chuck Swindoll shares his thoughts regarding this passage. He shares this. No one I know endured the level of hardship Paul did as a good soldier of Christ. What makes him more amazing is this. Never once does he leave a hint of complaint over being chained to a burly Roman soldier or about the inconvenience of being confined to such cramped quarters. The man simply would not grumble. By God's grace, he lived above it all. I repeat, he learned the secret of contentment. Start, people of God, by refusing to let your situation determine your attitude. Stop what you're doing and pray and worship. Get alone with God when you feel you're in prison and you can't do anything else. Paul and Silas were in prison, but when they began to worship, when they began to pray, there was an earthquake. How many of us can we serve that same God? He'll stop the whole earth and create an earthquake just for you. That's the type of God that loves us. That's the type of God that cares for us. And finally, if you don't know Jesus Christ, this is a challenge for you, or you strayed away from the Lord. It's simple. Paul said it, believe in the Lord Jesus Christ, and you will be saved. Let's all stand for a moment.